Hello everyone, we are here with Dr. Roman Töppel.
Hello.
And we have a very interesting and very detailed Patreon question from What Ismo, and I'm gonna read it out because, well, it's complicated. I have heard arguments that there was a reasonable chance for an operational breakthrough after Prokhorovka, given the damage to Rodmirov's tank army and Rodimev's corps. What is Dr. Töppel's opinion regarding German operational potential in this situation? And what potential ramifications do you think this might have had? From my understanding, the present Orthodox American historiography is that the Germans had little to no chance of meaningful success. However, I found myself unable to meaningful comment when it was challenged. I'd love to see your commentary on this.
Okay, sorry. You know, maybe you should mention that I'm not prepared, so I have to make it go into my mind because we didn't
rehearse this.
Rehearse, and she said, "Okay, this should be spontaneous." So just I hope I get it all together. That's that. What, afterwards, after such an interview, always say, "Oh, I should have said that.
Yeah, I should have
said that." So I try to get it together here. First, for the viewers who don't really know so much about the Battle of Prokhorovka. The Battle of Prokhorovka was like the peak in the south when Operation Citadel was going on. You know about Operation Citadel, and the Germans were going for Prokhorovka. And in Soviet and in Russian nowadays, Russian history books, they say it was a decisive battle and it was a blowing defeat for the Germans on 12th July 1943. And this was actually the turning point of the Battle of Kursk. And it was not. It was, as we know for 20 years now, it was a blowing defeat for the 5th Guards Tank Army, commanded by General Rotmistrov. And yeah, what would have happened? First, the Germans, I have to add this because it's a very recent discussion and I want to write something about this. Russian historians still cling on to the old myth. They say, first, the Germans were, they knew that the 5th Guards Panzer Army was coming. No, they did not know. I have checked all the files. I have checked from all levels of command. They really, the intelligence, German intelligence service failed. They didn't see it coming. It was a they were totally surprised, but nevertheless, because of a bad tactical planning and other reasons, you can read it in my book, it was a blowing a defeat for the 5th Guards Panzer Army. And there is also a discussion about losses. For 20 years now, a colleague of mine, Karl-Heinz Frieser, and I have done a lot of research, and I'm absolutely sure now, because I have seen all the documents, I have seen all the post-war reports, we are talking about total losses. I mean, not the knocked out tanks, but or the damaged tanks, we're talking about total losses. And when it comes to total losses, the 5th Guards Tank Army in the sector of the both SS divisions Leibstandarte and Das Reich, that was the main battle at Prokhorovka, 12th July, they lost 196 tanks as total losses, and the Germans lost 5 tanks. The Leibstandarte lost 4 Panzer IVs, and Das Reich lost 1 Panzer III. There was no Tiger loss, so I know maybe some Russians will never believe this. They say, oh, the Germans, they faked their fires or whatever. And just 2 weeks ago, I saw a documentary in the news in the Russians where a Russian historian claims, no, we have proof in Russian archives, in our files, in the Russian files, that the Germans lost 300 tanks. They didn't even have 300 available tanks. So it's 196 total losses on the Soviet side, 5 total losses on the German side. So it was a blowing defeat. And now I come to the conclusion. Many thought, and even Manstein said, now it was possible to break through. He really thought, not only in his memoirs, but also in his original war diary. I'm editing it at the moment, but it will take a while. You haven't seen Manstein's handwriting yet.
Okay.
And all the material collected, but it's a great project. And even in his original diary, he's so impressed by this Soviet losses, by this blowing defeat. He thinks, he really says, now the Russians are Russians are shaking. They are about to collapse. Now we have to continue, And then he's really disappointed when Hitler says, I have to stop Operation Citadel. And so this myth comes from Manstein, who really believed that it was possible to break through. And there is some two things to say. First, or three things. First, he didn't know that the 5th Guards Tank Army hadn't even deployed the entire 5th Guards Tank Army. He had the strongest of his corps, the 5th Mechanized Guards Corps, he had held in reserve. Yeah, because when he saw that his first Panzer Corps were crushed, he said it makes no sense to send further tanks in. Yeah, and so they had still reserves. There were other reserve Panzer Corps, Soviets coming from the operational reserves and from the strategic reserves. Manstein didn't know about that. Okay, he was far too optimistic. And the most important thing is that Manstein wrote in his diary that he cannot close the Kursk pocket when Model does not continue his offensive from the north. He says, our forces, even when we break through here and we can continue our advance to the north, we don't have the forces to close the Kursk pocket, the Kursk salient. Yeah. So he says, Army Group Center and 9th Army must continue its attack, otherwise it's pointless. So I think it was not possible for the Germans to break through because the Soviets dug in. They had, after this blowing defeat, they really dug in again and brought many reserves and Manstein wasn't aware of. But even if he had succeeded, if he had brought up the 24th Panzer Corps, he was always wanted to send to Kursk, even maybe if they had the chance, it would have been pointless. Because even if they had managed to break through, they couldn't have advanced and closed the Kursk pocket, so it would have been pointless. Yeah, this breakthrough. They had to break off the offensive in any way, because Model said, and Kluge, the commander of Army Group Center, he said there is no way this offensive is stuck, and we have to break it off. There is no way I can continue the attack. And Manstein is really angry, and he writes in his diary, he will not continue the attack, and so Citadelle must be given up, and all was in vain. And so, you see, I doubt, of course there will never be a proof, yeah, but I doubt that Manstein had succeeded in breaking through, and even if he had broken through, it would have been pointless, because they had to abandon the offensive in any way.
So it's pretty much, I mean, that's a perfect example why I like you so much. Because first, okay, that Soviet message doesn't add up the information, but also the wet dream of some people, like, it could have been a successful is also. No. So basically, you can. This is one of the examples where you have the one myth and you have the other myth or the other dream, and both is like, okay, this doesn't add up with the Archive data, and this also doesn't add up with the information that we nowadays know. And exactly. We know that the German intelligence on the Eastern Front was not particularly good, no. Because else probably Citadelle wouldn't have happened to this. I think you wrote that, I think, wasn't it in the book that like they assumed the one Panzer general that after they broke through to 20 kilometers or something of depth, that they achieved his operational breakthrough, but the defensive depth was like 100 kilometers or something.
Exactly, it was Hermann Breit who said after they have broken through the second Soviet army defense belt, they said, we had the operational breakthrough, but there was another army defense belt and there were three other defense belts before he would have reached Kursk, so it was over-optimistic. And of course, one has to say what you said, it's totally correct that we have knowledge now that they didn't have. Yeah. They couldn't dream of the reserves. So Fremde Heere Ost,
Foreign Armies East,
they failed even in detecting the entire Soviet steppe front, the whole reserve front. They failed, and if the Germans had known of the depth of the defense system and of the massive reserves, maybe they would have said, we should think about this another time, yeah?
I mean, you wrote in your book, I think, was it Kluge or Model, when Hitler and they looked at the air reconnaissance and they were quite scared already by...
Model, yeah. They said 20 kilometers. Model said, I need more time. We did a video about it. I need more time because according to these aerial photographs, the Soviet defensive system is 20 kilometers deep. And Hitler said, and Hitler says in this meeting in Munich, I think they meet with all the generals on 4th of May, and they discuss that, and they say, and Kluge says, Model is far too pessimistic. And Hitler says, no. He was optimistic. I'm the pessimist, says Hitler, yeah? And if they had known that it was not only 20 kilometers deep, okay, we have to say in the beginning of May, it was not finished. But if they had known that this was that deep and that well prepared, they're really surprised. You can read in the files, and they were really surprised when they saw this defensive system. That it's a fantastic defensive system. It's great. What the Russians did here, it's exceptional. Yeah, it's unimagined what they created. Yeah, and so there was this information was not available at that time. Yeah.
So, if you want to know more about the Kursk defensive system, I did a video on this. I mean, 500,000 people saw it already, and I think they quite liked it. So be sure to check it out, and it's based a lot on your research. So, wow. And I hope we answered your question, Vladismo. Thank you for your support.
Thank you for the question.
And thank you for joining us.
And thank you for watching.
Bye.
Bye.
See you next time.